But we're going to give it our best shot. How about that?
So aimless, life filled with sin, and I wouldn't let my new Savior in. Then Jesus came like a stranger in the night. Praise the Lord, I saw the light. Just like a blind man, I wandered along. Worries and fears I claimed for my home. Then like a blind man, the God gave back his sight. Praise the Lord, I saw the light. I saw the light, I saw the light. No more darkness, no more night. I'm so happy, no sorrow inside. Straight is the gate and narrow the way. Now I am traded wrong for the right. Praise the Lord, I saw the light. I saw the light, I saw the light. No more darkness, no more light. I'm so happy, no sorrow inside. Praise the Lord, I saw the light. Praise the Lord, I saw the light. Jesus comes tomorrow to spend some time with you. Would you answer all his questions? Oh, lie to hide the truth. Would you welcome him? Turn black as midnight in the middle of the day, and somehow you knew that Jesus would soon be on his way. Would you have to beg forgiveness? Could you reach out? Take his hand. If Jesus comes tomorrow, what then? If Jesus calls your number, could you leave today? Are you ready to lay down your worldly goods and walk away? Would it take a month of Sundays just to tell him of your sin? If Jesus comes tomorrow, what then? If the skies turn day, and
Come to you this morning, and we just thank you for the opportunity to be in your house of worship today. We know that we have a lot of our church members that aren't here today, and we ask that you bless them and be with them wherever they are and bring them back to be with us safely next week. Lord, we thank you so much for your goodness to us, for your grace, and for your mercy. We thank you that you have brought a wonderful message to us this morning from Chris, and we're looking forward to it. And may each one of us that are here this morning get exactly from that message what that you would have us to get from it. Once again, Lord, we thank you for loving us. We thank you for Jesus who went to that cross and died for our sins. And we ask all these things in your Son Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. How about another round of applause for ladies and gentlemen, I'm sure that you know, but this is your first time to visit with us, or maybe you've just been coming for a few weeks or whatever it may be. We are so blessed with musicians in this church. And one of the things, if you are a musician or you do sing or whatever it may be, if you want to find out how good you really are, sit down just in front of a crowd with just an acoustic guitar. That's where you find out. And I was just coming around the walls and walking up this way, and I really just didn't think that Chains Are Gone could be any better than what the band played it. But again, I continually show my ignorance, because it ain't going to get no better than what they just did. So, So, today, number one, I'm glad to see everybody here. Happy 4th of July, happy Independence Day, whatever you want to call it. Today, we are starting a new, we are in the middle of our Thessalonians summer sermon series. Last week, we finished up 1 Thessalonians, and we talked about what? The day of the Lord. And we talked about what the day of the Lord really is going to mean, and how so many people truly don't understand that when the day of the Lord comes, it's not going to all be good. If you are not a child of light, you're probably not going to be real happy when that day gets here. Today, we're going to start on Paul's second letter to the Thessalonians. It's going to be in chapter 1. So I'd love for you, if you would, to get your Bibles out, your tablets, your phones, whatever that you use to find your scripture with. And while you're doing that, I got a question for you. Any movie fans in here? Okay, let me ask you a specific question. Is there any Tom Cruise fans in here this morning? Hey, calm down over there. Remember, that picture's 30 years old. You know, I just pulled this one out of random. I know when, well, let me put it this way. If you're here and you actually recognize that picture, then we may be older than we want to let on that we are. Because there's a lot of teenagers going, who's that? The original Top Gun came out 30 years ago. Oh, my gosh. I think I was in sixth grade. Something like that. I don't know. But that movie was so good. What did it get? It took 34 years, but it finally got something. It got a sequel. Well, a sequel is when Hollywood goes, hey, well, this movie made so much money, we're going to turn around and spit out another one. What usually happens with sequels? Usually not near as good. Go back to one of the greatest movies ever made, Lonesome Dove. The return to Lonesome Dove, not so good a return. You know, and you can go through all of them, but the reason that I brought that up to you this morning is we're going to study for the next 4 weeks, a sequel, if you will. Now, Paul wrote this second letter to the church at Thessalonica for a reason. He didn't write it because of money. He didn't write it because they wanted to make a movie out of it. But he wrote the first letter, and less than 6 months, he had to turn around and write another one because of something that was happening. But let me read to you this morning. 2 Thessalonians chapter 1, verses 5 through 10. This is evidence of the righteous judgment of God, that you may be considered worthy of the kingdom of God, for which you are also suffering. Since indeed God considers it just to repay with affliction those who afflict you, and to grant relief to you who are afflicted as well as to us, when the Lord Jesus is revealed from heaven with his mighty angels, in flaming fire, inflicting vengeance on those who do not know God and on those who do not obey the gospel of our Lord Jesus. They will suffer the punishment of eternal destruction away from the presence of the Lord and from the glory of his might. And when he comes on that day to be glorified in his saints and to be marveled at among all of those who have believed, because our testimony to you was believed. Would you pray with me this morning? Lord God, we come to you. We have heard your word this morning, and I pray that every heart is racing, every pulse is quickened. I pray that our hearts and our minds are open, saying, Holy Spirit, come into it. Show us what it is you want us to know today. Why is it that this scripture has been brought to us? Why is it that this is being taught today? Lord, I pray that we take this message, that we learn from it. Most of all, that we take it and we use it to glorify you as we go out these doors. Lord, we love you and we thank you. And all the people together said, amen. Now, ladies and gentlemen, I know the Tom Cruise picture's funny and all that, but I do not want you to think that the second letter to the church at Thessalonica is like a movie, because it is not. Paul did not write that letter because he thought that he needed something. He wrote that letter because the church needed something. Now, we've been talking about for 4 weeks how important it was that we, as a standalone church of our own, have just celebrated our 1-year anniversary, and how the church at Thessalonica was celebrating its first birthday. But right after Paul wrote this letter, this powerful letter, someone else wrote a letter. Someone wrote a letter and sent it to this church, very possibly saying that they were Paul and giving them false information, telling them that their letter, that their sequel, was better than Paul's. So what do we get from this? Today, I want you to understand three things. Three things about God. Three things that Paul's second letter was written for. The first thing I want you to understand is when you think of God, I want you to think of this word. And this word is perseverance. This is point number one. God is perseverance. 2 Thessalonians chapter 1, verse 5. There is evidence of the righteous judgment of God that you may be considered worthy of the kingdom of God for which you are also suffering. How many people in here like that word? Suffering. Okay. Suffering's the pits, isn't it? C.S. Lewis once said, God's purpose was not to prevent you from suffering, but God's purpose is to sanctify you as his child. Uh-oh, he said one of them big words again. We talked about sanctification a few weeks ago. You have to remember, Jesus made you worthy when he died on the cross. But what does suffering have to do with it? Why does it seem like that all Christians, sooner or later, have to suffer? Well, the church in America doesn't even understand what the word suffer means. Could you imagine if you were in Iran or Iraq and got Saul with your neat little gold cross? That might be the last thing that you ever see, because they'll cut your head off for it. Or if you go into Afghanistan and they catch you with a Bible and they put you in prison for life. When God would judge the church at Thessalonica, would he consider them worthy? We've already talked about the suffering that this church was going through. We talked about all of the sexual temptation around the church. We have talked about in the Revelation class, if you're here on Wednesday nights, to take that class at 6:30 that starts back this Wednesday. If you've been there, then you would know how these people had their food cut off and how they had all of their incomes cut off. They did everything they could do to make them leave, to make them stop. They wanted them to worship the Roman emperor. But this church said no. It leads us to a powerful question this morning. Would this church be considered worthy? Would we here at Wilson County be considered worthy this morning? Endurance in trials does not get you to heaven. You're not graded on a sliding scale. The more you're persecuted, the better that it's going to be. But these people were literally persecuted day and night. And then the sequel came. Then that second letter came. And it came out and it gave them false information. It told them, you ain't got nothing to live for. It's over. There's not going to be any rapture. There's not going to be any Jesus coming to save you. None of that stuff. You done missed all that. That made them suffer. But you know what suffering does do for you? I love how he says, endurance in trials will demonstrate your worthiness because a Christian is made worthy by God's grace. So you suffering doesn't get you to heaven, but you accepting that suffering, that shows that you have accepted God's grace. It shows that you have accepted that free gift, and it also shows that God is good. Mark tells us, chapter 10, verse 18, and Jesus said to them, why do you call me good? No one is good except God alone. God is good because God is perseverance. You see, it's not the persecution, it's your attitude. How do you deal with it? What do you do? This is the decisive thing that you have to do. What makes you worthy of your salvation isn't when if someone comes up to you and they see that gold cross and they rip it off and you reach way back about Arkansas somewhere and come around with a right hook and lay them out. Yeah, I'll just knock that guy out for Jesus. Not the way it works. But when you look at that guy and you go, you know what? You probably needed that worse than I do. Have a good day. And you keep on about your life. That's what we are supposed to do. How do you respond in your daily life when things don't go the way that you think they should? I mean, how many of us here has literally give up? Oh, I'm going to show my age. How many of you here has literally give up on Ed McMahon sending you those millions of dollars? I'm so tired, I don't even go to the mailbox anymore. He's a liar. What? Oh, sorry, Ed McMahon's dead. It's somebody else doing it now. But they don't do what they say they're going to do. How do you respond? When the going gets tough, when people start to persecute you, what do you show? You show the sand that you should be full of? Or do you show the sugar? Now, if you're sitting in your chair going, what in the crap is he talking about? I live in Lavernia. It's sand everywhere. Sugar? I ain't been to the store. We got to go to the store at the church. No. This is a cowboy church. We use terms like being chock full of sand, having the bark on. If you're full of sand, that means you're tough. That means you've been through it. And when you're full of sand, things just roll off your back. But when you're full of sugar, what happens to sugar? It gets a little bit wet, and what does it do? Clumps up, sticks together. It's not worth nothing. When that old devil starts throwing rocks at you, do you show him sand or do you show him sugar? Do you continue to be worthy? Do you continue to be faithful that God will provide? Do you continue to show that you are a child of the light? Or do you look that other direction? See, that consistency, that faith, it can only come from one place. There's only one way that you can be faithful. There's only one way that you can show the sand that we hope you've got in you every time that old devil comes after you. And that comes from the Holy Spirit being inside your life. And that Holy Spirit being inside your heart. That's where it comes. It comes from a literal action of God that you have been inspired by God himself. Because you have to understand there is clear evidence. Philippians 1:28, do not be frightened in anything by your opponents. This is a clear sign to them of their destruction and of your salvation, and that is from God. Once you make that decision and you give your life to Christ, you become a true son or daughter of the light, then you have nothing else to worry about. God is not going to leave you hanging on the side of the road. He has brought you too far here this morning to leave you sitting somewhere. Just because things get tough, don't quit. That's what God was showing the world through the church at Thessalonica. They were being given bad doctrine. They were being given false information. But they continued to show God through their perseverance. They continued to show the world their sand, to show them that they were children of the light. So you today, when you walk, do you walk the walk or you just talk the talk? Do you show them sand or do you show them sugar? But the most important thing is, do you show them God's perseverance through you and your faith? And if you do that, then you will see that God is something else. God is punishment. This is point number two. 2 Thessalonians 1, 6 and 7. Since indeed God considers it just to repay with affliction those who afflict you. Let me back up and read that again because you're obviously not listening. God considers it just to repay with affliction those who afflict you. Everybody that hits you with a rock is going to get a mountain in return. And to grant relief to you as who are afflicted as well as to us when the Lord Jesus reveals from heaven. When Jesus comes, he's going to make it all right. Does it not make your heart just jump? When you start to think, you know what? They can call me names and they can ask me about my Jesus cruisers and all that kind of stuff, but it's all going to be okay because come one day when we look up and he comes down out of the sky and all those souls are coming with him, and I'm going to be sitting there going, yeah, buddy, see y'all later. Let them crabby old people talk bad. Let them worldly people that think they're so smart. We'll see who's smart. See, God made you a promise. He made each and every one of you a promise. Let them talk. Let them do what they're going to do. And when that day comes, tag me. Be like in wrestling, if you ever used to watch it, them little bitty 150-pound jokers, they'd reach out and tag Andre the Giant. He'd just step over the side of the ring, that guy in there going, ooh, and goes to running. Paul explained to the Thessalonians the great truth that was taught from the scripture, this book from beginning to end, from Genesis to Revelation. I tried to put them together. One thing that you've got to know, God is just. God is just. He is not going to let his children be hurt but so long. In fact, he will use a scale. He will balance justice. He will pass out trouble to those who passed out trouble. Galatians 6, 7, do not be deceived. God is not mocked. For what you sow, ladies and gentlemen, you will reap. See, that's kind of scary because that goes both ways. You can be a child of God and still not be sowing the things that you need to sow. You know that goofy term you hear so much, karma? There ain't no such thing. This is where it came from. God will take care of it. God will take care of you. He will take that old devil, and he's going to wrap him up in some chains, and he's going to send him straight to hell. And that's where he's going to be. God is going to give relief from trials, y'all excuse my voice, this mold is killing me, to those of you that have been unjustly persecuted, he will make it right. He will relieve pressure. And that pressure release will come to second coming. Just have to be children of the light. You have to remember that God is perseverance and that God perseveres through you and what you do as a saint. You have to remember God is just. God will deal out punishment to those who deserve it. You know, preacher, you were saying something about that in that Revelation class the other night. I've been thinking about it, you know, and you know, I think that, you know, I gave my life to Jesus, you know, I'm good on that. But this everyday stuff, you know, I just need to take care of that. God's got too much on his plate to worry about that joker keep stealing my lunch out of the refrigerator every day at work. And God's got too much on his plate to worry about what the tires on my vehicle look like. Ladies and gentlemen, I'm going to ask you a question this morning. Do you think that the God that created the world, do you think the God that created you inside your mother's womb, do you think the God that will come back and make everything right for a second doesn't have time to take care of you every single day of your life? If you don't think that that's true, if you don't believe that, if you think he's not big enough to take care of the backstabbing lying varmints on this planet, if you think that he can't take care of these violent field demons that you have to work with every single day, if you don't believe that, then you need to let me introduce to you the God of creation. Because you haven't met the right God yet. God will repay. He will show Luke 6:24-26. But woe to you who are rich, for you have received consolation. Woe to you who are full, for you shall be hungry. Woe to you who laugh now, for you shall mourn. Woe to you when all people speak well of you, because their fathers spoke well of the false prophets. You see, if everything is all easy right now, chances are you're living the way of the world. And if you've got it easy now, not going to be so easy later. But if you've got it bad now, the Greek verb means to pay back. It brings the idea of bringing and paying what is due. And that comes from the revelation of God, because he will come in blazing fire. And this is a term that you don't hear that much in the New Testament, but in the Old Testament, it was full of it. Exodus 3:2, and the angel of the Lord appeared to him in a flame of fire in the midst of a bush. And he looked, and behold, the bush was burning, but yet not consumed. Revelation 1:13, and in the midst of the lampstand, one stood like a son of man, clothed with a long robe and a golden sash around his chest. The hairs of his head were white like wool, like snow, and his eyes were like a flame of fire. He's going to have eyes like fire. God will show you what perseverance will bring you. He will show you that he loves you enough that he will take care of all of those who have punished you, those who have mistreated you. And he will destroy everything that has ever harmed his children. And by him doing that, then he shows us what he truly is. Point number three, God is perfection. God is perfection. And when he comes on that day to be glorified in his saints and to be marveled at among all who have believed, because our testimony to you was believed. Paul is telling the church at Thessalonica, you believed because you listened to us. Do you know why this world doesn't believe? It's because you're not telling enough people. we give our hearts and we give our life and we're like, okay, I'm in, all right. But you got to tell everybody else. It's not the preacher's job. What did we learn in Revelation class? We are all priests. We are all required to give our testimony. Fire and perseverance makes perfection. You see, there's a day coming when we won't be as we are right now. And what a day this is going to be. There will come a day that we will no longer be short and fat and bald. What are y'all laughing at? I guess that depends on your idea of perfection. I'll take it. I won't argue, but maybe I'm not glad you're back this Sunday. Done throwed me completely off my game. Give me a second. No, you're fine. There's going to come a day that you will not be as you are today. That there will be no more imperfections, whatever those imperfections might be. Because God keeps His word. And God has promised this. Because God keeps His word and God perseveres and God is just, that makes God perfect. See, in this verse, the word when, it tells us the coming is certain. The time we're not sure about. That wonderful song that Mike just sung, if Jesus comes tomorrow, ladies and gentlemen, there's no if to it. He is coming. It's just whether it's tomorrow or the next day. The coming is certain. Time, we're not sure. But what you have to understand this morning, God is coming to be glorified. And God, when He comes, He will be glorified by you. But not through your worship. Not through the things that the church does. If by the time He comes, if we have added on to this church and there's 800,000 in here every Sunday morning and there's 1,500 million in the kids' building, that's not what's going to glorify. What glorifies Him is what comes from your heart. See those trials that you have to go through, the perseverance that you have to show, that's what glorifies our God. It's by you showing that sand and keeping your eyes straight ahead. Christ will be glorified in you and not by you. We could be in here and we could sing like ain't no tomorrow. Jesus is not going to be worried about it. Say, what's in here? This is what I need to see. 1 John 3:2. Beloved, we are God's children now, and what we will be has not yet appeared. But we know that when He appears, we shall be like Him because we shall see Him as He is. See, that's the scary thing, ladies and gentlemen. We have no idea what perfection is going to be like because we've never seen it. What happened when Moses saw God's butt when he walked by? He glowed for 20 years. Adam and Eve in the garden, after they sinned, they couldn't look at God because if they had looked at Him, it would have killed them. We don't know what perfection is. It's not Tom Cruise, though. Thank you. What a day that will be when we are all as Jesus. When you are given that perfect body. And we will all be perfect. No more worrying about who's stealing your lunch at work. No more worrying about who bumped your car at HEB with the buggy. And the greatest thing to me, it's not just us that will believe and that will marvel, but it will be all believers. And when I say all believers, I mean from Eden all the way to the end, we are all going to be believing together. We will all be perfect together. I hope everybody knows how to sing in tune, because it might be horrendous.
He will be perfect. He will keep his word. He will do what he said that he will do. And at his return, he will take vengeance for you. Everything that every child of his has ever had to endure, he will repay. And at his return, Revelation tells us that he will destroy the armies of the world. Revelation 19, and I saw the beast and the kings of the earth with their armies gathered to make war against him who was sitting on the horse and against his army. The beast was captured, and with it the false prophet in his presence, who had done the signs by which he deceived those who had received the mark of the beast and worshiped its image. These two were thrown alive into the lake of fire. The rest were slain by the sword. These are the things that he tells us he's going to do. And you know how we know that he will do what he says? Because he's perfect. C.S. Lewis once said, there are far better things ahead than what we are leaving behind. If we don't have a church full of amens right there, then we've got a serious problem. There are far better things ahead than what we will leave behind. No matter how good that horse is, no matter how great that truck is, no matter how good your job is, no matter how good everything is, things are going to be better with Jesus. Wouldn't that be good on a bumper sticker? Things are better with Jesus. Write that down, honey. I'm liking patting that. And then none of y'all hear that, and that's going to be deleted off the video. What a day that's going to be. You know, we talked about Paul writing this letter and how it was a sequel to Thessalonians 1. You see, that's not the only sequel that you're going to get to see. You see, there's going to be a second sequel. And you know how most movies, you see them and then the sequel always hits? This one is going to be the exception to that rule. You see, when Jesus came that first time, the world said, oh, this is sorry. This is not a movie that we want to see. This is not things that we want to hear. And the ending to that movie kind of turns your stomach. Yeah. Things that Jesus did, but he did for you. But the sequel, ladies and gentlemen, the sequel. See, it's not going to be Tom Cruise in an F-14. You see coming down out of the sky. It's going to be Jesus on that big white horse. And that sequel, see, that's going to be a sequel that nobody will ever forget. You see, because the ones who persevere, they're waiting for it. The ones who try to keep you from it, oh, they've got punishment coming like you would never imagine. But most of all, the best thing about this sequel is going to be the God with his Son, Jesus Christ. They are perfect. And all they want is you. That's all they want. It's for you to be there on that day. Would you pray with me this morning? Lord God, we come to you today. I pray that Lord, I pray this world. I pray for this church. I pray for every church,
every true church that reads your book and that preaches your word. Lord, it scares me to think about all the bad sequels out there. All the letters that have been written, all of the imposters that are standing behind your pulpit, that are standing in front of a cross on a wall, and they're telling and they're preaching things that are not true. They are preaching things that are going to damn their congregations. Lord, I pray to give you thanks for a servant as worthy as Paul. That Paul stood and Paul answered. That Paul wrote these two letters that we can sit and we can read and we can look and go, this is the truth. This is what we know to be right. This is what matters. Not what I think, not what my opinion is, not what it might mean, but this is what it says. And we take it. Lord, I pray for Christians the entire world over. I pray for our brothers and sisters in the Middle East that literally worship at the expense of their lives. Lord, I pray for our brothers and sisters in China, in Japan, where they worship at the very expense of their lives. Lord, most of all, I pray for the Christians right here in the United States, Lord. I pray for the Christians who just don't listen. I pray for the Christians who can memorize every song that ever comes on Spotify, but they don't know anything about your word. Lord, I pray for the men and the women who go on social media and they spout such drivel. Pray for the ones that believe that murder is okay because it makes it easy for them. Lord, I pray for your sons and daughters who persevere. I pray for those men and women who are here this morning, Lord. They've come and they've heard your word and their heart is swelled. And as we get ready to take communion to remember what your son actually gave for us, I say, I cannot wait to go through this door and tell somebody what the preacher said this morning. I can't wait because I can't take a chance that they end up in hell because no one ever told them about you. I pray, Lord, that every Sunday, that is the goal of every man and woman that leaves this building. I've got to go and tell someone about Jesus. I want heaven to be so full that we got to add on to it. That they all won't fit. How awesome would it be if we could save the world and that old devil wouldn't find anybody to try to fight you? Lord, I pray most of all that this message finds the home that you intended for it to find. Whether those people are here today or whether they will see it on YouTube or whether they're going to hear someone come into HEB and just walk up and put their arm around them and say, let me tell you about my Jesus. Lord, I feel your presence this morning. I feel your power in this building. Most of all, Lord, this morning, I just want to say thank you. I just want to say thank you for loving me. Thank you for sending your son to make me worthy of that love. And thank you, your son, making everyone here today worthy of that love. Lord, we love you and we thank you. And together, all God's children say, give me just a second this morning. We're going to be We're going to be back with Paul again in 1 Corinthians. If you'd like to open up your Bible and read along. But first, I would like to ask, if you were here today and you were not a member of God's church, if you are not a child of light, then I ask you to not take this. I ask you, if you have a grudge in your heart, if you have hate in your life towards someone, then I ask you to not take this. Because the scripture tells us, whoever therefore eats the bread or drinks the cup of the Lord in an unworthy manner will be guilty concerning the body and the blood. Let a person examine himself then, and so eat of the bread and drink of the cup. For if anyone who eats and drinks without discerning the body eats and drinks judgment upon themselves. For I received from the Lord what I also deliver to you, that the night that the Lord Jesus took bread, and when he had given thanks for it, he broke it and said, this is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. And in the same way, after supper, he took the cup. And he said, this cup is the new covenant given in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it. Do this in remembrance of me. Would you pray with me? Lord God, we ask you to bless these sacraments, Lord. I ask you to bless them, that we truly understand what these sacraments stand for, Lord. That this grape juice is your blood, and this wafer is your body that was brutally beaten and given so that we would be made worthy, that we would be justified, that we would have the opportunity to see you. Lord, I just ask you to bless us as we leave from this building today. I ask you to bless us as we get ready to worship you with this last song. Most of all, Lord, I just ask that you keep this congregation safe. As they know that this is the 4th of July weekend and people are out traveling, or people will be leaving from here and going to grandpa's or grandma's or wherever they may be going, Lord, I just ask you to be with them and keep them safe. Lord, I ask you to bring them all back here next Sunday. But most of all, Lord, I ask that you tell them as they go through these doors, tell somebody about Jesus. You don't have to be theological. You don't have to use big fancy words. Just put your arm around them and say, you know what, brother? Or you know what, sister? Jesus loves you. And he's coming back to get you. Let us do that this week. We love you, Lord. We thank you. And we ask this in your name.
Please stand and join us.
There is coming the day when no heartache shall come, no more clouds in the sky, no more tears to dim the eye. All is peace. What a day, glorious day that will be. What a day that will be when my Jesus I shall see. When I look upon his face, the one who saved me by his grace. When he takes me by the hand and leads me through the promised land, what a day, glorious day. sickness, no pain, no more parting over there, and forever I will be with the one who died for me. What a day, glorious day that will be. What a day that will be when my Jesus I shall see, and I look upon his face, the one who saved me by his grace. When he takes me by the hand, leads me through land. What a day, glorious day that will be. Oh, what a day, glorious day that will be.
Real quick before we go to the Lord in prayer, I don't know if y'all have been paying attention what's been going up in Washington, D.C., the Supreme Court. You know, 2 weeks ago we had the issue with the abortion thing. Well, then this week, I don't know if I heard about it, there was another big decision the Supreme Court made, and for me, my point of view of being a coach, I thought was just as important. The fact that they ruled that the individual person, teacher, coach, whatever, basically what happened was at the end of a football game when all the kids left, he got on the 50-yard line, got on knee, and prayed to his Lord and Maker. And so some people who don't agree with that basically said he was in violation of the First Amendment, the separation of church and state. Well, this past week, it was Monday or Tuesday, the Supreme Court decided, no, that is not, it's not in violation. So and so that could go along with the message today, is the fact that when we step out and we say, yes, we are children of God, yes, we are going to do what you have told us to do through the Bible, you're going to get persecuted. And when you do, say, thank you. That's what I want. When you're not persecuted, that means you're not pushing against the devil. Because they say, oh, he's easy. He's an easy shot. It's when you get persecuted, when you are a threat to him. So, amen on that. So, here we go. Lord, thank you once again. Thank you for allowing to come to your house and study your word. Lord, I pray for this country. I pray for we can understand the true meaning of what this country is all about. The fact that you need to go back to your history and understand that our founding forefathers were men of God and women of God first before anything else. And that's why this country was made. And we have gone so far off the beaten track, it's scary. But hopefully, Lord, I pray that over these last 2 or 3 weeks, as we've seen what's going on in this country, that we understand that you are still with us. You have not left us. It's unfortunate because we do not hear you. You are so loud we can't even hear you because we are on our own way. Lord, thank you for who you are. Thank you for this country that we live in. Thank you for the blessing you bestowed upon us. Thank you for your grace. Thank you for your mercy. Thank you for our freedoms. Because sometimes we don't realize what other Christians do throughout the world. The fact that we have the right to express our beliefs freely without persecution. And as we go out these doors, Lord, I pray that we all know that and see that and find somebody that does not believe in my Lord and Savior and say, we need to talk because the day is coming. And by that time, it's going to be too late. Thank you again, Lord, for who you are. Thank you, Lord, for what you are. Thank you for your grace and your mercy. And above all else, Lord, thank you for your Son. Without your Son, nothing else matters. And I pray. Amen. You are dismissed.